Hi folks, this is David Atum Kwan. Here I'm recording this video on September 11th, 2014. Yep, September 11th. This is 13 years after infamous 9/11. And so I don't really know where I'm going to go with this video. I might just end up blabbering on about nothing. But I do just want to record, just do a blog on this day, even though most pretty much by the time I upload this video, or by the time anyone else sees this video, September 11th will have passed. So it's not necessarily that I'm doing this so that people will watch this on 9/11, but it just gives me an opportunity to talk about it 13 years afterwards. Now, 9/11, to me, doesn't have a personal significance, let's say. You know, I don't have any family members or friends who died or suffered from this terrorist attack that happened on 9/11, 2001. And when this happened, I was a junior high school student in California. And it was kind of, the day just went on like any other day, pretty much. There was kind of a feeling in the air. I remember in the morning, my friends and I, you know, we were at the bus stop waiting for the school bus to come to pick us up to take us to school. And I don't remember whether it was a parent's car who was dropping up a kid, or maybe it was a bus driver, but I do remember, like, the radio was on, like AM radio, just a news radio, just talking about this 9/11 that just happened. And so that's all I remember. But the rest of that school day was a pretty much practically normal school day. I think there was an announcement by the school principal or the school administrator or whatever, just announcing something terrible had happened in the nation, and it's something that we need to have a moment of silence for, or something like that. But for the most part, we were junior high school students. We didn't really concern ourselves with that. We were worried about our classes, our classwork, our homework, boyfriends, girlfriends, and, you know, all the things that junior high school students talk about or care about. And kind of, it was then. I was young then. I was just a young, really young adolescent. So that happened. But, you know, although that is my story, I know that the story of 9/11 for this nation is one of the most impactful, pretty much the most infamous day of American history. And it began as that. And then once that happened, I think so many things just changed. It was an impact to the rest of the world because of how U.S. from that point on responded to this event of pretty much the worst terrorist attack ever in the United States history. So I think it's worth remembering this holiday, and just to be able to just talk about it, you know, especially it's kind of relevant now with all the talks about U.S.'s future potential involvement again in Iraq and in the Middle East and things of that nature. So before I get too into that, also, I do want to also just kind of talk about 9/11 and the people who were there, to workers who pretty much risked their lives or really did heroic things in there. Many of them, their legacy still lives on, but I don't think this country has done them enough justice. You know, a lot of them are still suffering. You know, first responders, so we call them, the people who went by ambulance, the firefighters who went there, say people did a bunch of things for the people who suffered in 9/11. The families of victims of 9/11. And people of that nature, some legislation was passed to help them as possible, but people still today stay that who have been directly impacted by 9/11, they're still not getting the support and help they need. So that's something to still keep in mind, and something that we should be kind of, I don't know, fighting for and being kind of positively outraged about, you know, outraged in that something should be done for these people And we need to really take care of our own people that suffered, and not just worry, not just focus so much on attacking, on killing, on invading other people. So that's something to keep in mind, and I really like, don't know why this comes up in my mind, but right now I'm thinking also of something that Bernie Sanders, one of our senators, he said this kind of thing. It's kind of related, you know, if you can't take care of our soldiers when they come back home, don't send them to war, you know, and that's that message that I think has been kind of lost or just forgotten or ignored after the events of 9/11, because we just got so gung-ho, and so it was a shock to us, so we had to respond in some manner, and the way we responded has kind of resulted in this way, just kind of being unaware and being ignorant of the fact that 9/11 itself was a response by terrorists to historical presence of U.S. in the Middle East. The history of U.S. in the Middle East, even before 9/11, is a messy one. It's not a pretty one. U.S. has done quite a lot of things, I think, that makes sense why the Middle Eastern people are so angry and so outraged. That huge terrorist networks like Al-Qaeda formed. I'm not justifying Al-Qaeda. You know, I don't support terrorist groups like that, but it you know, in history, groups form in response to something, in hopes of doing something, and it's all kind of, there is a cause and effect that we need to be mindful of. And the United States was a part of this causal effect chain just as much as Al-Qaeda was a part of a cause and effect change that's still kind of going on today. It is a cycle that's still going on today that's about to really ramp up as the Obama administration is kind of talking about, well, it's already sent, there's already going to be about 1,000 American troops, they don't want to call them troops, American servicemen, pretty much in military uniform with military weapons, but they're not to be considered boots on the ground for whatever reason. It's like we're entering back into a war, but it's not really a war. That's what we're doing. We do have, Obama administration has gathered up a coalition of different nations to attack ISIS again, to degrade, destroy, and what was the last one? Something, dismantle ISIS as an organization. So this one actually feels to me like a war, like a really big war that could possibly happen, and I'm really terrified of it, and I'm always reluctant. For me, if I was a policymaker, you know, my approach is to always be reluctant to use military in this manner. There are specific instances when I think military is needed, you know, and war, even though I would rather avoid it, has to happen. But looking back at the history of the Middle East, I wouldn't agree that much of that had to happen. I'm of the opinion that we made a total mistake in going to Iraq in the first place, you know. And the bigger mistake was not that we went to war and removed Saddam Hussein and all that. That was a big mistake that pretty much caused this chain reaction cycle of, you know, of tension and conflicts between the ethnic groups and the religious groups that were already kind of boiling over with hatred and kind of a power struggle there before Saddam Hussein was removed. But once that happened, oh man, that kind of just went insane. But the bigger mistake, much bigger mistake, was of course that Operation Iraqi Freedom turned into Operation Enduring Freedom. Invasion turned into occupation and nation building. Military wasn't just used to defend our nation from threat from outside, as military usually should be used. or sometimes military is used for preemptive defense, you know, eliminate the coming offenders so to defend our nation for security. That was that rhetoric can be used, but nation building is, you can't really use that rhetoric anymore when you are using the military to build the democracy of another country. You can't do that. You can't build a democracy with the military force. It's a weird reasoning, and then you can't, you not only that, you also can't expect that democracy that was encouraged to be fostered with the use of military. What do you expect that democracy to be on your side? Well, they're on your side because they're coerced to be on your side. So of course, that democracy is not going to be the democracy that you want. And so I know there's a big national interest in being involved in Iraq. Like, for example, why Iraq and not any other country? Of course, there's oil there. There's natural resources that the United States could profit off of and use for its own good. And that's a big part of it. You know, now, after we pulled out of Iraq, after U.S. has pulled out of Iraq, now there was whole this power struggle and whatnot, and ISIS and ISIL has formed. And this is, of course, terrifying. ISIS or if you call it, President Obama calls it ISIL, is a terrifying organization. It's become so big and so kind of powerful that it's, for me, it's even hard to call it an organization. It's almost like a nation state even. Of course, their ultimate goal is to form a caliphate that is strictly adhering to their view of what the Quran or Islam states. And yeah, it's terrifying what they're doing. And I don't think there's an easy solution to this. Although why United States should get involved, I think is a question that we need to address first before doing anything. You know, why are we responding in this way? I've always thought responding to terrorism with military force is kind of the wrong way to do it. Because you use military force, like I said, to defense of the nation from an external source or a preemptive defense of an encroaching force that's pretty sure to invade us and attack us. And you can also use military for specific campaigns, such as it was done in Iraq in 1991 by Bush's father, President George H. Bush. He attacked Iraq, and then that was it. And then everyone just came back home. There was no notion of occupation and nation building. It wasn't to fight terrorists. It was to just fight a country. When you use a military to fight an entity that can be fought, that follows the rule of war, I think military force can be successful. Like I said, I'm not a very big proponent of using military or getting into war. I find the argument that war can be justified to be really hard to agree with. I don't, you know, I'm almost to the extreme opinion that no war can be justified. It's just that sometimes we get into it with our good intentions and reasons or whatever have you. You know? But terrorism, I think, is a different beast altogether, because it's one in which civilians can get involved. There is no identifiable entity that follows the rule of war and the code of conduct during war that entities will agree on. Even North Korea, if we fought against a war against North Korea, they will still abide by some principles of war. But an organization, the terrorist organizations like Al-Qaeda and whatnot, they will not. You treat terrorism, I think, the way we treat criminals, like how FBI goes after, I don't know, drug kingpins or something. And it's an investigative work. It's detective work. You know, it's to root out the sources of recruitment and to kind of figure out who's the mastermind, and you disrupt that. instead of sending an entire army, the world's most powerful army, navy, air force, whatever, and bombing the shit out of everyone, and occupying a country where you're not the defenders, you're not the originators of that country. It'd be one thing if United States soldiers were occupying United States territory for defense purposes, but it was United States soldiers occupying a totally different country for the defense of United States and not Iraq. Although the rhetoric is that we're building democracy in Iraq or whatever, and there's a lot of photo ops, and I'm sure there's a lot of positive things that actually did happen with the occupation of Iraq. You know, schools were built, transportation system was built, and things like that. But the bad, the cost far outweighs the good that we've done. And so, ultimately, I think Iraq, and even Afghanistan for a lot of reasons, was a big mistake for the United States to go in there without really solid reasoning why the United States had to get involved. Why United States? You know? And so now Iraq is torn apart with ISIS and the Iraqi government that exists that is trying to combat ISIS, trying to be allies with Iran, which is very, very strange because Iraq and Iran have been not friends for a long time. And then there's Syria involved. So it's a situation where if United States does get involved, they have to be allies with Iraq, which is, you know, we've been kind of allies with Iraq for a long time now, but United States also has to be allies with Iran and Syria, with Bashar al-Assad. And that's makes for strange bedfellows, for sure. And it's pretty strange. I liken ISIS to a nation state, not only because they're big and powerful, but also because they are doing things that not just terrorist organizations do, but they're not just terrorizing people, they're not plotting just attacks, but they're also doing nation building of their own. They're building, they're policing, they're handling traffic, they're providing utility services to residents, they're trying to build schools and whatnot. They're doing nation building. It's crazy. Trying to gain popular support, although there is a lot of coercion and brutality involved in this kind of control. I was listening to Slate's Gabfest, I think, political Gabfest, talking about ISIS. Is the model of ISIS sustainable? If it's as brutal as it continually is, I would think not. It's not sustainable. Although North Korea is an example where it's a country that is cornered, you know, it's pretty much put into a corner, and no other country supports North Korea except, you know, perhaps China and Russia in certain circumstances. But ISIS is put into a corner like that too. It's in that corner, and there's no one supporting ISIS, and so, you know, if we kind of attack the rhetoric of ISIS and try to kind of support or dissuade people from joining and whatnot, I think that's probably more powerful than going there. It's almost like ISIS wants it to happen. ISIS wants the United States to come and attack them. And two things, you know, I mean, that could mean that United States is with a coalition of other nations. It's a powerful military force. ISIS could be defeated. Although that leaves the question of if ISIS is defeated, then what? You know, does United States just leave and let it be? Which I hope that's the answer, even though the aftermath will be terrible. Or, you know, what happens then? Does United States and coalition occupy Iraq again? Although there is this other possibility that because United States and the coalition of countries gets involved and gets into this quagmire of a war where both sides are killing and dying and being hurt and there's massive casualties on both sides, then ISIS has a rhetoric to be able to further recruit and become more powerful and expand more. Because as we now know, ISIS is starting to expand to Libya and to other countries. It's getting sympathizers from pretty much unlikeliest of places. You know, Denmark, Netherlands, people in UK, some of them, some very few amount of people, but some people actually are abandoning their sheltered lives, their homes that they've known, and going to Iraq or to Syria to support ISIS, to become members of ISIS. And I think that's crazy. And the public response to many of these people, and I've read comments on Facebook and on online articles and things like that, the general comment has been, oh, we shouldn't ever let those traitors come back to our country. We should go over there and kill them for the savages or for the awful people that that ISIS are. You know, I can understand that sentiment in a way. It's hard to empathize with that sentiment, but I can kind of understand why they would feel that angry about people joining ISIS, because ISIS is, from the looks of it, it's one terrifying, awful, awful, evil group. You know, but now the people who've gone away from home and joined ISIS, now they've gone to a point of no return with comments and sentiment like that. So they're gonna really devote their cause and their life to ISIS. And if ISIS is to grow bigger and to gain more of those supporters that way, using its network, you know, its social media and its internet savvy skills or whatever for recruitment, the more recruits it gains that way, the more those recruits will be diehard, suicidal, devoted to the cause kinds of terrorists or kinds of people who support ISIS, not necessarily in a terrorist fashion, but in a nation-building fashion, and that's even more dangerous. Because Al-Qaeda is a terrorist network. It is not this thing trying to become a nation state. It has a political agenda of influencing other political bodies. ISIS is different. ISIS is not trying to have a political agenda like that. It's trying to become an empire. You know, it's trying to become a country of countries that's allied together, unified with one same Islamic creed, religious creed. So the way we combat this is definitely going to be different than the way we need to combat something like Al-Qaeda or other terrorist organizations. And that's why it's kind of, it's a hard question. What do we do? But I think the first question hasn't even been addressed yet at this point, is not even what do we do or how do we get involved. It's really why. Why do we get involved? And I think that question is still hard to answer. Why the United States needs to be involved in this? Is it the fear that ISIS will grow big and therefore it's going to be like Nazi Germany, and so not responding is like appeasement, you know, in that way that we let ISIS be, then we're going to have, and then the ISIS is going to succeed. From the way I look at it, the way ISIS kind of recruits people and the way it funds itself, it's not a sustainable model. The way it is, that kind of brutal totalitarian governance and coercion, it is not a viable model to have a long-lasting country unless it's supported by other countries. The only reason North Korea is surviving the way it does is because it has the support of its neighboring countries like China and Russia, and also because it's put into a corner by South Korea, so it has this desire to fight everyone and survive so well, you know? And it's also a nation that maybe it is totalitarian, but it provides, in its own way, in its crazy, horrible way, a service to its people with this rhetoric of utopian communism. You know, it calls itself the Democratic Republic of Korea. It doesn't call itself North Korea. Or actually, the correct translation is 대한민국, which means one unified nation for the people and by the people of, yeah, by the people, for the people and by the people. That's what the name of the nation actually means. So that's the rhetoric that North Korea uses for itself. ISIS hasn't got to the level of being able to develop the rhetoric for its populace. But I don't know. I don't want to say it's a matter of time, but it's anyone's game what's going to happen. But this is the legacy of 9/11, that we became so shocked, so terrified that, you know, American people have been really just riled up and been able to be duped to get rid of their, to allow themselves to be rid of constitutional rights, such as the right to privacy, and just, you know, and we've given up so much of our liberties, and we've allowed so much bloodshed to be done in our name after 9/11. And so this is where we are right now. Yeah, I think I blabbed on for a long time. I'll end it there. Any questions, any comments, whatever, you know where to leave them. Bye.